In 1984, the toy company Hasbro brought over Takara's Diaclone and Microchange toy lines in the Western markets as the Transformers. The 84 and 85 Transformers lines were a smash success, with a marketing blitz of comics, commercials, and the most important of them all, cartoons. The Transformers cartoon aired September 17th, 1984 with the episode More Than Meets the Eye Part 1. The cartoon was an immense success, propelling Transformers to become one of the top toy brands of the 1980s, and allowing them to beat their biggest competitor, Tonka's GoBots, that beat them to the market by a year. The Transformers followed a war of the Autobots and Decepticons, two factions of a species of alien robots hailing from the planet Cybertron. The war draining their home planet of resources, the Autobots flee into space and are chased down by the Decepticons, causing them to crash into a volcano 4 million years in the past, awaiting the day they come out of stasis in 1984, and with that a host of new characters for kids to call their favorites.
Of course Optimus Prime, but I like Bumblebee. I kind of even like the bad guys too, you know? If I had to pick one, I had the Optimus Prime tractor trailer toy set, which is super expensive in the 80s, you know, like $20 back then in the 80s was probably like, I don't know, like $100, you know, back then, you know, so who knows, maybe 70. But if I had to pick anything other than the main character, probably Bumblebee was probably my favorite.
I'd say that Prowl really stood out to me as one of the off-the-beat guys that I really enjoyed. Of course, the Dinobots. Loved the Dinobots. They were just, you know, dinosaur robots, and the way they spoke, it was so much fun. Not sure I had a one favorite, although from the toys, that was a little different because, of course, there were more toys than there were from the show. And for me, some of the toys that really stood out were maybe like Fortress Maximus and Metroplex having to transform an entire city into a robot, I thought was just great.
Transformers would go strong in 1985, introducing fan-favorite subgroups including the Dinobots and the Constructicons. 1985 would finish up most of what Diaclone and Microchange had to offer, except one character in particular. In the 1980s, Hasbro was a very successful toy company, seeing the success of all three of their biggest brands at the time, being My Little Pony, G.I. Joe, A Real American Hero, and of course, the Transformers. Hasbro decided they wanted to venture on a silver screen with all three of their biggest brands. The scripting of the movie began August 15th, 1984, almost a month before the cartoon even aired. The first script was penned by Flint Dilley. The title of this iteration of the script was Transformers: The Secret of Cybertron. It should be noted that this script is considered lost media. The plot of this draft would have involved Optimus Prime delving into the core of the planet Cybertron to find the true origins of the Cybertronian race, to defend themselves against the evil alien race called the Quintessons and their planetary-sized weapon Unicron. The titular secret of Cybertron would have been the planet itself was a Transformer. This concept never came to fruition in the final movie. Simon Furman would eventually create the exact concept years later, the god of the Transformers, Primus, for his run on the Transformers in Marvel Comics. The Primus origin of the Transformers would eventually become the preferred origin compared to the Quintesson origin in the cartoon. Flint Dilley would eventually rework The Secret of Cybertron into Season 3's 5-part opening, The Five Faces of Darkness. The script was finalized by Ron Friedman May 2nd, 1985. The storyboard for the script would also be finalized that same year in December. The budget of the movie would be around $5 to $6 million. The movie was released August 8th, 1986 under the title of The Transformers the Movie. The movie was panned by critics, citing that it was just a big toy commercial. The movie broke even, with its box office returns being $5.8 million. While sounding bad in today's movie climate, it's not as bad as you might think. In the 80s, if a movie didn't do well in the box office, home media sales could make up the lost profit in strides. With the advent of streaming, it's a lot harder to make a profit on movies that bomb in the box office. That's not even including the toys the movie was selling. To this day, almost 35 years later, you can still go to the store and find products based on this movie. The film ended up with a PG rating. In today's world, that's meaningless. Every animated feature is PG. But this was the 80s, an era before PG-13. Having the 80s PG stamp meant something. The logic behind the decision was that G movies are played less than PG and R films. On top of that, that would force parents to go see the movie with their kids, driving up ticket sales. So, to get that coveted PG rating, they had the character Spike, the main human protagonist of the first two seasons, swear. Flint Dilley objected to this line in Ron Friedman's rewrite of the script. It was added into the script late into production by executive meddling. Ultimately, it created the second most jaw-dropping thing in the film for its young audience. The movie was animated by Toei Animation, the studio that would eventually become famous for adapting the mangas Dragon Ball and One Piece into anime. Ironically, the anime adaptation of Dragon Ball started the same year in April. The movie would have an iconic soundtrack, featuring songs like The Transformers by Lion, Instruments of Destruction by NGR, and Dare to be Stupid by Weird Al Yankovic. But the breakout song of the movie was The Touch by Stan Bush. The song was originally written for the Sylvester Stallone movie Cobra, but the recording company decided that the Transformers would be a better fit. In an ironic twist of fate, the feature star of the 4th and 5th live-action Transformers movies, Mark Wahlberg, would sing the song horribly in the movie Boogie Nights. The movie would feature an all-new cast of characters from the latter half of the 86 lineup. These characters would feature an all-star lineup of voice actors. Judd Nelson as Hot Rod, Lion Alexander as Cup, Eric Idle as Wreck-Gar, Robert Stax as Ultra Magnus, Leonard Nimoy as Galvatron, and Orson Welles as Unicron. Yes, Orson Welles, famous for his reading of War of the Worlds, Citizen Kane, and Frozen Peas. When Welles recorded his lines, they were barely usable due to his health issues at the time. Modification was required to make them usable. Orson Welles would record his voice on October 5th, 1985. He would die 5 days later, making Unicron his last performance. August 17th rolls around and kids flock to the theaters. Every kid in the audience was excited to see their favorite characters on the big screen. But instead, what they got was a bloodbath. Almost the entire 84 cast of Autobots was killed off, most of them unceremoniously. But the death that affected everyone was the death of Optimus Prime.
So for a 7-year-old kid who was kind of nerdy, just to paint a little picture, I had asthma, I didn't have a lot of friends, you know, it was like, I literally cried, and my mother was like, are you kidding me right now? You're crying? And I felt like saying, this is Optimus Prime, like, you know, like, so like my old man worked a lot, you know, and I have a lot of friends, so, you know, in a really pathetic way, that was kind of like a father figure, you know, like Optimus Prime. So my first thought was, what's next Saturday's Transformers gonna be like? There's no Optimus Prime. It literally brought tears to my eyes.
You remember these things because, you know, you're 10 years old, 11 years old, and, you know, first off, the first, like, 5 minutes you find out the entire series was useless because the Decepticons won. They took over Cybertron. They made it back, so they won. Then they kill off all the main characters, including Prowl, in, like, the first couple seconds. And now they're destroying the city, and then all of a sudden Optimus gets into this fight, and a random little hand blaster blows a hole in his side. And I'm like, I've seen him get hit like 1,000 times. Oh, he's fine. And he's lying on the table dying. And I'm going, and I remember looking at my dad. My dad's like, it's okay. You know, he'll probably fall unconscious and he'll come back later. And he gives over the thing and it's still okay. And then he turns gray. And he looks down at me and I'm like, oh. And it was just, the whole theater was like, what?
Optimus Prime wasn't just a cool toy. He was a father figure, a real hero to many people. The voice actor of Optimus Prime, Peter Cullen, designed the voice based off of his brother Larry, who was a Marine. He designed the voice to be courageous yet gentle, something the live-action movies forget. For many kids, they truly lost someone who meant the world to them. The reason for the grief starts not with the Transformers team, but with the G.I. Joe team. Around the same time, the G.I. Joe movie was in development. Originally, in the G.I. Joe movie, they were going to kill off the main character, Duke. The Transformers team decided they were going to kill off Optimus Prime, so he could be replaced with the next Autobot leader. The G.I. Joe movie was delayed a year, but at that point the scene was animated. Hasbro, not wanting another Optimus Prime situation on their hands, decided to add in a line saying Duke was in a coma, and added a new ending to the film. It also didn't help that for all intents and purposes, the character who was replacing Optimus Prime as the main character was blamed for the death of Optimus Prime by fans. For a long time, Hot Rod was hated by fans that started in 1984 and 1985. On the other side of the pond in Japan, this most likely wouldn't have been a big issue. Shows centering around robots usually tended to swap out characters frequently to sell new toys. The Japanese continuity featured many characters taking up the mantle of the leader of the Autobots, the only issue being that Japan did not get the movie till 1989. Despite all the negativity, fans loved the movie. Despite being a bloated toy commercial, it didn't treat its audience like kids. It told a more mature story. While in the short term it almost killed the series, in the long term it defined the franchise. For its 35th anniversary, Hasbro had It and Beast Wars, which was having its 25th anniversary, be the focus of the 2021 lineup, in the Studio series and Kingdom lines. It even came back to theaters for a one-time Fathom event. This movie and its legacy has truly brought fans of the franchise closer together. Till all are one.